Sirdam, and I'm gonna call to order the select board meeting of July 24th. First on the agenda, as always, is approval of minutes. I had no changes to make, it was a short meeting, and I had. So are we good with the minutes?
Yes.
Okay, so fine sounding, thank you. Any community input tonight? All right, we'll go on to department head business, and you appear to be the only one.
Hey.
So come on down.
I was gonna say, go on your list.
Oh, all right. So first of all, thank you. The board doesn't know yet, because I haven't done the budget, but Chief Ducharme allowed us to siphon off $5,000 of one of his budget lines to help balance off the town maintenance line, which you will see when we do the budget. All right, you're on.
Okay, the first item, we've had this rash of needle fines and whatnot in the town, so what I'd like to do for the officers is actually order a pair of gloves for everybody. They'll be needle stick resistant, and they'll also be cut resistant, so you can use defensively if someone's trying to slash you, whatever the case might be. So I purchased order number 1255, North Galls. Line item number 257 out of our uniforms, line item 13 pairs of turtle skin duty gloves at $59.89 each for a total of $778.57. I'm estimating shipping around $20. So I've got a purchase order here for $798.57.
All right, I'm going to purchase order number, I'm going to move it. I scribbled my name, but I can't read. 1255 to Galls for 13 pairs of turtle skin duty gloves for a grand total of $798.57, and that includes shipping.
Second.
Any discussion? Actually, I have a question. Did you say turtle skin?
Well, that's the brand name.
Oh, that's the
turtle.
Oh,
that's not a corner called turtle skin. That's just the brand name.
I was just curious.
Only the best. Exotic skin.
Wow. What does a turtle have that, you know, makes it?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Sorry for my ignorance there, but thank you. All right, I'll call a question then. All those in favor say aye.
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 Do we have a, sharps box to dispose of needles in downstairs?
No, what we actually have is we have individual tube containers that we put them in. If we keep them, normally what we're doing now is we've got a handshake agreement with your gamble, just bring them right over there, throw them in their sharp box.
Perfect.
Okay.
Are you done?
Well, I just swiped Jody, so I do have them. You can go.
Okay. We need to either certify or recertify our TASER instructor this year, and in speaking with the lieutenant, he's actually willing to allow Officer Sherwood to be the TASER instructor in the future in this place. I think it's a great idea to get some additional training to some of the line staff. So I have a personal hand in 1254, made out to Police 1, line item number 715, that's our pro-development line item. For Officer Philbert to attend one-day TASER instructor certification course on September 19th, and that's $435.
For one TASER instructor certification course on September 19th for a total of $435.
Any discussion? Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
While we're talking about training, I would like to send Officer Hancock to a four-day field training officer class. It's being hosted by the Roger Williams University at the Falls Police Department. I'd like Officer Hancock to actually train Officer Pasquale when he gets out of the academy this December. So I purchased number 1224, made out to Roger Williams University, line item number 715 for development, to attend four-day field training officer class for $575.
Second.
Move purchase order number 1224, to Roger Williams University for one field training for $575.
Second.
So is this, is Roger Williams where we sent the lieutenant?
That's where we sent the lieutenant.
So they have this sort of specialty or concentration in police enforcement?
Yes, they do, yes.
But this is...
They actually took over for, I think it was Babson College.
Okay, but they're doing this in Hollis?
But they're doing it in Hollis. They send their instructors out, you know, for regionalized training.
Yeah. All right, excellent. Yeah, for sure. Any other questions or comments? All right, all those in favor say aye.
And I know you have an excellent memory, you remember this from last fall, but we received that grant from the folks in Concord to put scanners, a GPS unit, and a printer in each of our cars. It's, they'll pay for four units for each community within the state, and that's part of the J1 program.
Mm-hmm.
And the purpose of the J1 program is to eliminate paper and allow things to be just transmitted electronically in the future. The J1 program is hoping by the end of this year that the court system will be completely paperless, with the exception of the one piece of paper you print out in the car to give to the defendant. And the DMV is hoping to be on board that when we start filling out action reports in the cars in the future, it'll be the same thing. It prints out two pieces of paper, three, one for each driver. You hit send, and automatically goes right to the DMV. So when I'm printing paper here, printing reports here, and then making copies of them to physically deliver or send to the Concord.
Isn't that more streamlined? Isn't that a wonderful thing?
It is. So I have purchased, so they will give us the Brother Mobile Solutions kit, which includes the printer adapter for the battery cavity mounting block, USB cable, drivers and software, four global sat GPS receivers, and the Altron image and scanner. We just need to purchase the headrest mounting units, a 7-port USB hub port, because everything that plugs in, they're on a ports in the back of the computer, so we have to put one of those. And I figured I'd get one case of paper at the reduced price. So, purchase order number 1230, made up to Glacier Computer, for a grand total of $4,881.44. $3,086, which will be total reimbursed to the town of Rollinswood. So all we're paying is $1,795.44. Again, that's for the headrest mounts, the USB 7-port USB hub unit, and the case of paper.
You can call a question now. I don't have to do it.
Okay. Okay. Purchase order number 1230 to Glacier Computer for
Four Brother Solution Kits.
Per GPS. Per Chief Dusher.
Yeah, no, I should have been nice, but it's encapsulated all, but I think I couldn't read it all. For Four Brother Mobile Solutions Kits, four global satellite GPS receivers, four Eltron image scanner, Four Brother printer headrest mounts, four powered 7-point USB hubs, and one case of paper for a grand total of $4,881.44.
Second.
Okay. So my question is, we are going to have to pay the $4,881. I mean, the net effect of the town. So does your line, whatever line is coming from, does it have that money in it?
The $3,096 come out of the Homeland Security reimbursements.
Okay.
The $1,700 come out of my equipment line item.
I see. Okay. Got it. All right. Any other questions or comments? All right, then I'll call. All those in favor say aye.
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 And one thing that's nice about this here, if we get this here and we install at the same time, a two-way puts in my radios, it would be a minimal labor fee, if any at all.
Because they'll already...
Because it's already there and working on it, which brings me to this item right here. In an effort to increase officer safety when they're out of the vehicle and on their portables away from the cruisers, whether they're on an accident scene in a house or downtown, whatever the case might be, We're looking at Bluetooth units for the radios, okay? Essentially, what happens is the officer wears the Bluetooth unit, and within about 150 to 20 feet from the cruiser, the Bluetooth will be in sync with the cruiser radio. So when he talks on the Bluetooth unit, it's not going to the portable, which has less wattage. It's going right directly to the cruiser. So we're using our own cruiser as a repeater to get the dispatch.
Mm-hmm.
And what's also nice about these units, when the officer starts to leave or get away from the cruiser and get out of range of the unit, it starts to beep to let the officer know.
Mm-hmm.
If the officer, for whatever reason, needs to continue past that point of no return, the unit automatically kicks over to the portable unit. So at no time will the officer have to worry about, you know, which radio do I need to grab, mm-hmm. and all that stuff. So they're really nice units. We actually tested it last week downtown. It worked very well down behind the Lower Mill, down by the Legion, down on Sligo Road. Okay. And again, if we order it now and they put it all at the same time, Two-Way said there will be no additional cost for later to install this. So our purchase number 1226, Mail Two-Way Communications, line item number 280, which is our equipment account. A 4 Motorola long-range wireless RSM kit with vehicle chargers for a total of $1,995.98.
Okay. We took that purchase order 1226, the two-way communication for 4 Motorola long-range wireless Bluetooth kits with vehicle chargers for a total of $1,995.98.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Signing.
Okay. Purchase order, City of Dover. Install and balance one tire on Cruiser 74. Apparently, we must have run over a large spike or something like that within the last couple of weeks. So we had a new tire replaced on that for $140.36 and $25 in labor. And then there was a repair. We put a plug in a Cruiser 73. We put a repair plug in a tire on Cruiser 73, and I think it was from the roofing job here because it looked like the nails for the roof is here. So they didn't charge for the plug, but it was $12.50 in labor. So purchase order number 1214, mail to City of Dover, line item number 707, vehicle maintenance account, $177.86.
Move to accept purchase order 1214 to City of Dover for various labor charges on vehicle 74 and 73 for a total of $177.86.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And the last one, purchase order number 1227, mail to Sullivan Tire, line item number 707, vehicle maintenance account, yearly alignment for cruiser number 72 for $89.99.
Ooh, purchase order number 1227, the Sullivan Tire for one alignment of Cruiser 72 for $89.99.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Item number 2, last Thursday's storm. Rollo and I and a few others were up in Farmington enjoying the cloudy weather up here. Apparently, get hit with a storm down here.
Yeah, it was impressive.
We actually had a number of roads that where trees came down and trees on wires, including Barrow, Sligo Road, Silver Street, Portland Avenue, and the parking lot of WDH, the parking garage. Some construction equipment got blown within the thing there and damaged a vehicle or two up there. Officer Phil Work and the fire department did an outstanding job in clearing up everything as soon as possible. And even EverSource, you know, the problems that they had in Madbury, Barrington, and Rochester, and Dover especially, they were here rather in a fairly timely manner and managed to get the power back on in town here. So kudos to Officer Phil Work and the fire department for doing a great job last night.
Yes, indeed. And also Jeff, I think Jeff was out on the road too.
Was he out there?
Yeah, he had called in from the city of Dover for, to help Dover.
Over there, right, yeah.
So, yes.
I was aware, our reports didn't say anything about our hiring on it, but.
I think that's because they were, he was in Dover.
Probably because he was in Dover, yeah, so.
Okay, good.
Yeah, so great, thank you so much. It was quite a swarm.
We were inside on a nice tour, we didn't even see the ground.
Well, you know, Judy called me, she called me from, you know, Members Way, you know, the doctor's office.
Oh, yeah.
Just, she'd come out of the building, she was calling about something else, and she was in the car, she says, oh my God, the sky just opened up. It wasn't doing anything in Rollinsford. Yeah.
Picking up the kids.
And so, but I used that as a heads up, and I started, you know, I put the umbrella down, and I closed windows, and all was, God, it just looked like this, and it was raining sideways, the wind was blowing sideways. So, anyway, yes, so I hope everyone was safe, I know many of us did lose power in Rollinsford, but kudos, yes, and to all of our crew and staff.
Okay, give me an update, coffee with the chief?
Yes.
We had six folks in attendance. The majority of time was spent by answering questions and giving an update to the progress on the status of the police department building committee's progress. Well, there were some concerns on Heritage Drive, some speeding vehicles, some folks being in the cemetery after hours when they shouldn't be there. And a big issue was the amount of trash that's being strewn out of vehicles on the dumps open, especially along Main Street here.
When the dump was not open?
No, the dump is open. So what's happening is it's flying on the back of people's trucks and trailers and whatnot, so. We're going to see if we can address that a little bit, and maybe also send out a public announcement saying, hey, you know, just be a little mindful of the trash and the back of the vehicle and things like that, so. The old highway building on Silver Street. Mr. Dan Burke from Burke Street Service would like the building. I know that the town put out a couple of bid notices and nobody responded to that.
I reached out to him directly.
Who's got?
I sent him an email.
Yeah, I spoke to him last week, and he's interested. And he's willing to take it off our hands, or your hands.
Is it the same person?
Yeah.
Oh.
Wonder why he didn't respond.
I sent him, I said, are you still interested? And I sent him the invoice,
the bid.
Thank you. And never even.
Well, he told me he was busy at the moment.
Yeah.
And really said, hey, you know, if you want to get rid of the building and nobody else has put in for it, I'll do you guys a favor and I'll get rid of it for you. So, you know.
Don't tell us what it is, because we'll just put it out to bid again, it'll probably be the only one. Is that not too fast enough for him now? Now he wants it like this?
Well, no, I think he's willing to just take it off our hands without having to pay the town of Rollins or anything for that service, as opposed to us having to, at some point, maybe hire someone to take it out.
Oh, he just wants us to, oh, he, I see.
So.
He doesn't want to give us anything.
Right, so in my talk with him, I alluded to the fact, well, you know, there's a bunch of trees up there that could be trimmed and cut down in the event that we ever do something in the future. Maybe we can talk about that in the future. So, no promises have been made or whatnot, but not that I would. Told him that I would talk to you folks tonight to let you know that he's willing to take the building off your hands to save us possibly the expense of having to demo it.
So when Jody, you looked at it, and how much would it cost to demo it?
Demo it, you're looking at $6,000 to take it all away. So, because you have the demo, plus you have sending it to the metal piles, and then you have concrete walls. And does he just?
I thought he just wants the building, you know, the metal siding and the roof.
Yeah, so it's just on a slab, right? There's no foundation, right?
It has, if I remember right, it has those barricades, like 3 feet up, kind of thing. And then they build us a steel on that. I'm remembering right. But then it's also steel.
Did that demo, did that also include the two outbuildings as well, to demo all of that, was that just that one building?
I think just the one building, it's not pulling up right now, but. Says it's still loading. Almost got Suzanne's computer tonight.
Slow Wi-Fi tonight, so. Cloudy in the cloud, no.
So I'm a little uneasy about just sort of giving something away. I mean, what does the rest of the board feel?
Well, I think it was like nominal.
Yeah, something nominal would at least.
$100.
I don't know what I consider nominal, but just, you know.
Well, I mean, if you could ask for a nominal fee, or you could ask for in-kind service too, if you're willing to cut down the trees around it.
Is he a tree service, is that, I'm sorry.
Yeah, a tree service.
Oh, all right, I missed that, okay.
I think you can get more, but.
So just a sort of a barter arrangement? Did he say he was amenable to doing that?
Well, no, I just suggested to him that, you know, that we have a bunch of trees eventually that might need to be cut within the fence line, or even on the other side of the fence line. And I just said, I'll bring it to the select board, and, but no promises have been made.
And we have all the dead trees in that one.
Yeah, do we think we're gonna need to get that much for it, I mean?
Well, no, we got no bids, how many times did we put it out, Jody?
Twice.
Twice, so, I mean.
So.
Yeah, we gave them 120 days to remove it after acceptance of the bid, to remove the building from the property. Aluminum shed at Old Highway, approximately 40 by 20, including doors. We did not put a minimum bid.
Well, let's.
Sold as is.
Let's see what kind of transaction it has to be if we're going to, I'll talk to the municipal association.
And it's specifically a building only, no land involved.
Yeah, I don't know what kind of document or what kind of whatever, but I guess we can respond that we are interested in this, we will pursue this.
Yeah, I mean.
Oh, I'll send them the bid form again.
They might get more response if you talk to them.
Just talk to them?
I called him.
Okay.
Yeah, and he said he was still interested, he gave me his email address directly. And then, I'll send it again. I hear you're interested again.
Still.
I mean, the advantage is that we don't have to worry about it being vandalized again, like it was a couple of weeks ago, I don't think it was 5 weeks ago it was. You know, and if we truly do want to utilize that site for, moving forward for a police station, some of the prep work is taken care of, so it's.
And it might help with, you know, I don't know if you see it that much in the road, but you can, I mean, it's kind of an eyesore, it doesn't really fit any of the, you know, residential.
That is true, that is true.
But.
Normally, that would be very uneasy, right, given the fact it's gonna cost us 7 to 8 grand to get rid of it, if we want to do it ourselves, and it looks like we're moving in that direction. It's my mind, right, I think we're moving in that direction, that it solves a problem for us, but I completely respect folks that might feel uneasy, so.
Well, you know, might there be other people who would be willing to take it off, right, you know what I mean?
Yes, but we've already done it twice, right, we've already put out the bid.
But we were looking for a bid, not for a bid of zero, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, fair enough.
This is a bid of zero, so. So that's what makes me just a bit uneasy.
Do they want to pay to take it down themselves?
I mean, isn't the metal worth something, if you bring it to a.
Sure, probably is, but the question is it worth $78,000, or $67,000, whatever it was to remove it?
It's not worth the time and the effort.
Right, there's that, like.
The labor involved, tear it all, you know, take it all down, and.
Yeah.
By bolt, by bolt.
But I don't know what the scrap metal.
And if you do it the easy way with an excavator, you go to hire the excavator.
Just gonna knock it down, yeah.
At $120 an hour.
Yeah, okay, so I mean, are you.
And the truck at $60.
So, all right, so how would the board like to, do you want to talk to him, Jody?
I'll call him.
Okay, and see if you can arrange some kind of barter service, I will check in with the municipal association just to see if we need some kind of document or something to, with regard to a transaction. and...
Had we not sent it out to bid twice before, I would say absolutely not, we can't just give away a town asset like that, but I mean, we've tried.
Yeah, I agree with that.
So, that makes me go a little bit, the thing that really keeps sticking with me is that it costs $7,000 to $8,000 to remove it. I can't imagine it's worth that much, I just can't, but, again, I'm not in the scrap metal business, so...
Okay, well, let me just check with the municipal association.
Yes.
That, and then Jody can talk to him, and so we'll hopefully can get this resolved next week.
I imagine there probably, there might be some expense and some demo up there, because you still have remaining cement.
Yeah.
And I think the two outbuildings as well, I'm not sure how much we'll be able to demo, we might be able to get rid of the wood, but, I mean, you know, there are two large cement retaining tanks up there that we're probably gonna be rid of ourselves, so...
Mm-hmm, so there's still be some.
So having said that, I mean, it's $6,000 to demo that one building, you're probably talking less than half that to do the remaining cement and whatnot, so... I'm saving this year in my budget, so hopefully I might be able to do that towards the end of the year. And get it done on this year's budget as opposed to trying to budget for next year's.
Well, do you think that, I mean, is this the recommendation that you think is going to come from your committee?
The, for that spot, I think that's the direction that we're gonna get.
I'm not gonna speak for the entire committee yet, because we haven't made a formal declaration, but in my mind is the site that's probably best suited for the use currently. It's not to say that other sites couldn't be used, but there would be a lot more prep work that would need to be done with other sites if we're going to purchase them, so...
Well, is the committee willing to hear, do you hear from interested parties when you meet? I mean, I have a concern about Silver Street in that I worry that there is just no room for expansion, if anything has to change, if you need to...
You can go up.
Go up.
There is some, well, still Bob Thunder, because he's got the survey there.
How much expansion are you looking for? Say another 20 years, if the police department had added another couple of rooms, whatever, that's not going to be an issue. If you're looking to expand, to add a fire department, that's not going to happen at that spot. If you're looking to add...
It would be, even just for the police.
Yeah.
I just worry about, you know, changing law enforcement and changing requirements, and now you need a this, whatever that this is. Not just the size of the force, but also the other...
There is room there for that. If the plan was to put the town hall there as well, but you'd be on the second floor, there's still plenty of land room to do that. However, there would not be enough room land-wise to have everybody on the same floor.
Okay, well, I will definitely keep an open mind.
Do you want us to talk about Farmington? Do you want to, because I'm going to have to do it at the end of the night anyway, we just went to our activities, but... Do you want us to talk about it? Well, all the chiefs here. I mean,
sure. I would love to know. I mean, I realize this is not the committee. I understand that.
Right.
But just a little informal update, shall we say.
Well, the sergeant gave us a tour. The sergeant and an officer gave us a tour. Nice facility.
And this is the concrete?
This is the concrete method, yes. And the owner's son, who drew up the plan for us, was there, as well as their engineer was there.
Mm-hmm.
They did a tour as well, and they gave us the lowdown and LED lighting as opposed to incandescent. Some lights in the common areas are on motion, so they shut off, so you're saving electricity. They talked about the insulating factor of the wall itself, and how energy efficient that building is, and you know, they anticipate that the Farmington Police and Fire will save over what they had been paying in the past, some around 50%, and at least 50% utility costs alone. So the building looked nice as well, because it's brand new, because they all look nice when they're brand new.
Sure.
I think probably the only downfall that they didn't have there, which many of us have the same problem, is there's just never enough storage space. So,
Well, I mean, we still have this building, so I mean, we might have to schlep, but...
You know, they talked about how they insulate the lobby area there for the police, fire, and the police side and the fire side with some metal behind the wall, and how the windows where the secretaries sit, they have movable Lexan, thick Lexan glass, so that makes that bullet-resistant as well. The wall itself is bullet, almost bulletproof, because you're talking, you know, about 8 inches of cement, so... So they need it very nice.
Certainly a clear advantage, too, to having, to knowing that you already own the land.
Right.
Yeah, I was very impressed with the, one, the layout of the building, the construction. I thought it was, the builders also brought a cutaway of the wall to show us how, you know, how it's constructed, which was very impressive as well. I had an opportunity to spend some time with some people from Farmington, actually, on Sunday, and they had nothing but praise, actually, for our building facility. They were, you know, the taxpayer, that was well done and well worth their money. One of the things that was really nice about Farmington, now keep in mind the safety complex, which fire and police, but they had a very large community room also. So the plans that were drawn up for us also included a space that could be used as a community room. I mean, it could be a little larger if we needed to use as well. It could be a room, I mean, you would have loved it, Suzanne. It had a smart board, it had everything you could imagine. It had a wonderful projector, so you could actually use a smart board, I mean, but it was furnished by Grace from Homeland Security also, but anyways, which is also a plus, but it could be used for select board meetings, it could be used for planning board meetings, it could be used for the ZBA meetings. I mean,
So it'd be large enough to hold select board meetings then?
Correct. If it was the same size as the one in Farmington?
Is it, is it like this size? Is it comparable to this
size? It's 24 by 38 or something, something to that effect.
Bigger than this.
Well, that's interesting. Again, you know, I'll tell you why it's interesting, because you know, the amount of time that we're, or the amount of money that we spend to keep this building with, you know, its ambient temperature, you know, within certain ranges. I mean, even if we, you know, if we kept this floor busy, we could look for, you know, we wouldn't have to. You could have things on timers, is what I'm thinking.
Exactly.
So, you know, if we don't have any night meetings, then we're really talking about the 4 or 5 hours, whatever it is, that those offices are open. And, you know, maybe we can look for ways to do more direct.
Anyway. It's just an advantage, I thought. And one I hadn't really thought about until we saw what Farmington was doing. So, now they still have their town hall, or they still meet there, I guess, but a little durable moving around in my mind.
Anyway. Yeah. Why not?
It was impressive all around, to be honest with you. I was.
Yeah. And is that community, so have they given you a design? Is this what?
Yeah, they have.
What floor is that community room on?
First.
Ground floor, okay. So
I don't have a design to include the town hall.
I understand.
All I have is I gave them my general design.
That's okay. That's appropriate.
And they drew up that. You know, if you add the town hall to the second floor, then, you know, a couple of rooms have to be moved downstairs. You have to go an elevator shaft, and of course you have to have a stairwell as well, a fireproof stairwell, things like that. But it can be done. It can be done if you want to
think about that.
Yeah. But you wouldn't want to build the police department this year and then in a year or two add the town hall, because then you're cutting off the roof to put the second story on. So if that's what the long-term plan is, we all move together and we're all happy together and be together and just have the one large conference that we can all share, then, you know, that's the time to do both at the same time.
I wonder what the neighbors would think about a two-story.
Again, it looks residential, so, I mean, the house to the left is a two-story, the house to the right, all the houses, several up to the right are all two stories.
And in Farmington,
the
they had
is a two-story.
They had two stories.
The Farmington was a two-story on the fireside.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It does not look like a, you know, it's designed not to look like a commercial type of theater. It's designed to look like a residential.
Mm-hmm.
I am. I think that I was very impressed. The way it was described was in the plans. It was hard to imagine until you really saw it. And it was very impressive. So.
All right. Well, thank you for that.
But also, I guess all the chiefs here too, so we're not doing this in a vacuum. Folks on the committee are also looking at the idea of contracted services. Because I'm sure some citizens are going to tax it, they're going to say, well, you want to spend all this money to build a police station. Wouldn't it be cheaper just to contract with Dover or Summers or whatever, state police too, or county? And Charlie Putnam has graciously taken it upon himself to do that research, which is good for him. And the initial research that he has found, it doesn't look like really there's any cost savings, to be honest. So with the level of service that we receive now, certainly, you wouldn't get a comparable level, a cost level. So that's just the initial work that he's done. So he's still looking into it for us, but.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's not for me. It's not for cost savings. It would be if it were too difficult for us to manage a police force the size of our force. Now, so far, we've been okay, but we do have difficulty sometimes finding people. And if we can't, you know, we don't have, if you're in a larger department, you have a better career path. And it's hard for us to provide a good career path. So it's not so much a cost savings piece as if we ever get ourselves into a position where, you know, we're finding it just too difficult.
Well, the takeaway from there is that it probably could be done if we had to. Yeah. I don't believe it's to our advantage to do that, but from what I've read so far, but it could be done.
Yeah, and that's good to know. If we, you know, like I say, I don't think we're in that position. We're not in that position, but, you know, things, you know, 2 years from now, 3 years from now, 4 years, you know.
Charlie thought it would be a good idea at least to look into it.
I think it's a good idea to at least know.
From the cost savings side.
And then we could answer questions, which is a good thing to do.
Yeah.
All right, well, this is exciting.
Moving forward, that's all we need.
Yeah, that's great. When do you think the committee might be coming to us? Did I ask you that already?
No, I think we still need to meet. Not everyone showed up at the farming facility, so we still need to meet and talk about that. And talk about, having an architect come up with the plans first and then putting out the bid or doing what they suggest,
an RFP.
And you put that out to like his company and the other folks that have given us an estimate. And say, here are the plans, you submit to us your detailed plans and what it costs you to do that, and then we'll look at it. And then that's what the town of Farmington did. And he said the town of Farmington had received three RFPs, and they chose Rowan. And when you do it that way, the engineering and the drawings are already done ahead of time. So you're not paying an architect to design it and then put it out to bid, and hopefully you're getting, you don't run the problem that we had here when the architect said, it's going to cost you $700,000 to renovate it when all the bids came in at $1.2 million or higher. So it's design, build process right from the beginning. The builders know exactly what the design is going to cost. So when they tell you it's going to cost $1.2 million, it's not $1.3 million or $1.4 million by the time the project is done. It's $1.2 million or $900,000, whatever the case might be.
Well, where do those plans come from, though? If you're not going to an architect,
we give them, like I have already, the basic drawing of these are the rooms that we need.
So it's not an architect's drawing, it's like a specification.
And they draw up their own drawings for what they need for their building trades.
Okay, I see what you're saying.
Which, they've done some of it, the folks that did the Farmington one, and then the folks that did the module build as well. They've done some of the drawings as well.
And I indicated then that we would, given the magnitude of this type of project, that an RFP would be.
Oh,
it would be something that we would want to do anyway.
Right.
I feel pretty confident.
So it's just a question of what are the specs that we do? Is it an architectural drawing or is it
in
something like what you just said?
And then the design build route is really one we would want to pursue. I mean, because again, it's a guaranteed price. It's not, okay, this is the estimate, now we'll send it out to bid and then we'll try to find this is what it will cost. This is similar to what the school wanted to do when they were talking about their renovation, but they gave, I don't remember what it was, how many options, three, four, five, whatever the options were, I don't remember. And they have a plan, you know, a guaranteed price for each of those options, right? It would be some, that's what Bruin does.
Well, they were, it was a slightly different model, because they were hiring a...
Right.
A project manager who was gonna guarantee the price, you know, I don't know.
Based on the build, the design build model.
That I don't remember, but... So I don't know that it's exactly the same, but it doesn't make any difference. I mean, it's whether, you know, if this sounds like a good way to go, then it'll be a good way to go. Any other comments, questions? Anything else in your grab bag there?
Yes, I got a present for you.
All right.
This is the survey done by Cardigan Nunn.
Yes.
And the property is actually, it's a little bit bigger than I anticipated it would be. You can see in the front, you got 246 feet of frontage along Silver Street. On the north side, it goes back 228 feet, on the south side, 200 feet. So it's actually in the shape of a trapezoid.
Yeah, I see that.
So we've got almost 40,007 square feet there.
So this is our copy?
That's your copy. They sent three copies, so we'll have one for the committee.
Yep.
And with your permission, I'll just keep one with my master file.
Absolutely, sure. Does he have digital?
No.
Do the snail mail.
No.
Does anybody, wanna see it? All right, excellent.
I heard from Dover Fire and Rescue last week, and apparently they have been in contact with York Ambulance about taking over the ambulance services for everything along the Oak Street, Gilman Hall, Double Bowl, and whatnot. Apparently they have formalized their agreement. They're just waiting for all necessary signatures. And I said, well, it's fine and dandy, but once you get it signed, you need to forward it to me so I can present it to the board and get the board's authority for you to do that before we institute it and notify the 911 folks. So I'm anticipating sometime within the next couple of weeks I will get a copy of the signed agreement so we can actually take a look at it and see exactly who's doing what over there.
Okay. But as far as you know, it's completely amicable and they've...
Yes.
It seems to make sense to both parties.
Correct. I mean, years ago, I'm talking about many years ago, it was a handshake agreement that Dover just responded all mm-hmm. to all those areas anyway. And lately it's been... York and Dover going up to both being dispatched to the calls up in that area, and like Kelwyn Drive, American Ambulance, as well as York being dispatched to the same call. Mm-hmm. So we're just trying to finalize it so you have one ambulance taking care of a certain particular, you're not wasting resources by sending two ambulances for the same call.
Yeah. That
makes complete sense. I mean, the response time has got to be a third of
You just don't want to tie up a safety. Well,
of course not. Oh,
right?
No, I agree.
And the last item that I have is I came in the station last Wednesday or Thursday, I think it was. Wednesday.
Does this have anything to do with the Townsend truck that I saw?
The Townsend truck and the fire department here, yes.
Well, I didn't see the fire department.
They came in with their wet vacs for us and the water pumps. The HVAC unit in the mechanical room let go. And fortunately for us this time, it leaked into the catch basin for the oil drums. So all the water went in there. So we had 6 inches of water within the catch basin of the oil drums. So we didn't have any water infiltration in the rest of the building. It just dropped in the right spot. And again, the guy, after he swore and whatnot, again, he's saying it's a design flaw, the design flaw with the entire system is not draining properly, and that he did some changes and things and whatnot and cleaned it out and whatnot. So he was here for several hours, and we had the fire department come down with the pump and suck out all the water and then dry it back, what was left in the unit.
So does he think, did he fix this? I guess I'm asking, is this going to happen again, or
doesn't think it's going to happen again because he rerouted a couple things, but the system in itself, it's just got so many flaws and where the water is drained to that it could clog somewhere farther down the road and you could have those problems. so. But this is the first time we've had that issue with that unit down there, so. Our biggest issue has been the one, the newest one out there. So hopefully that might last another 10, 15 years, or until, if we move out here in a year or two.
Who's gonna alert us when there's water down there? You know, we'll have to see, it'll be seeping up to here.
Well, if we leave, we'll have to make an inspection once a week, or once every couple of days, or whatever downstairs, I'm not sure. But we can put a water sensor in the unit down there.
That's true.
We have for the water heater.
That's when you reach it.
Remember, we've now blown two water heaters down there. So we actually installed a water sensor in the basin of the water heater, so if that lets go.
You will know.
The alarm will go off, and we'll know there's water issue going downtown, so downstairs. So in the future, you know, we might consider putting a water sensor in the catch trap of the oil basin.
All right, well, thank you. So we don't have the invoice yet for that, right?
No, we don't.
Yeah, okay.
That's all that I have. Anything for me?
Well, it's quite a list.
It was a list, yes.
I don't think so.
There seems to be a car downtown that, I don't know, has been abandoned from Connecticut. It's been there since Friday, in the two-hour parking spot on Main Street, or Front Street, rather.
Are you sure it's moved? Because I've gone down there and checked several times and.
It's that first spot, if you were, the first spot if you were heading towards Southport. Under the sign, there's, I don't know what kind, I don't know what kind of car it is, so maybe the station wagon, Connecticut, could get the Amtrak station.
I'll.
It's just weird, it hasn't moved that, I don't know, it's been in the same spot every day, why am I taking the dogs, I don't know.
Yeah, okay.
And they might get home, so.
I know the folks on Front did a complaint about some cars on the other end, have been parked there for quite some time, but, so we managed to quell that issue rather quickly, so. Main, take a left towards, Main Street, take a left toward Main and Connecticut Place, all right?
Well, when you're at the stop sign on, from Main and Front, you'll see this, right? It's the first parking space on the other side of the street.
Okay.
Like, where you're gonna turn into the.
So there's an apartment sign, kind of building sign.
Yeah, right underneath that, but the first space.
Check that out.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Nothing else, right?
Enjoy the rest of the night.
Thanks, Steve.
Now, I saw Chief Rutherford, but I don't know where he went, so. I guess we'll just march through then. Maybe he's looking for a room.
He was looking for Caroline.
Okay, thank you. All right, ordinance housing standards, I'm guessing we're tabling that.
It was, you were the one who wanted to table it, so.
Oh, I wanted to put it on hold?
You wanted to, yes, so. You wanted to look into it some more.
We have to change it. We've got things to do with it, it's not ready.
Correct.
Yeah, so it's a good point. So how, the question is, we have this, we have welfare policies. So which of those two do you want us to tackle, and then we can figure out how best to.
Let's do welfare first, and then we can do minimum housing.
All right, is that good with them? All right.
What do we have left for welfare?
What do we have left? It's like 70, I don't know how many pages it is. I'm more than halfway through, but I haven't read it all, and I've made comments.
Okay.
And I've given you the link so you can see what my comments are. And so maybe what we can do is, one approach is to, for, you know, just take it a section at a time. And then kind of go through.
I suggest we do a work session next week. And work on it.
Maybe an extra day?
No. Start at 6 or something and just do a work session on, just work on that. Or, I mean, we don't have.
Yeah.
We have a.
We could do that. 6 o'clock.
Agenda.
So it would be the meeting, or we could do a budget work, so not budget, we do a workshop meeting from 6 to 6:30, is that what you mean?
Yeah, and just work on that, and then start the regular meeting at 6:30.
6:30? All right, does that work?
Yep.
Check.
I'm just double checking my son.
Another 7.
No.
And the date is July?
31st.
31st, 6 o'clock? We would not need you, Salman, for the workshop session, so you could still come in to 6:30. All right, that's a good idea.
Or if you think that just starting at 6:30, I mean, we could do our normal.
No, I like the six.
Were you thinking that?
Six is better, I think is better, I'm saying there are other options, but that's.
I think we're all saying we can be here at six, so.
Yeah.
Let's do it all, we'll have Caroline notice that. All right, very good. Joe's Garage, I think we're still looking for plans, so there's nothing new there. Chief Rutherford's not here. Highway, Doherty Lane, snow damage, Caroline is supposed to be working with you to draft something.
Drafted a letter. And I thought, it might be in the folder.
Oh, maybe it is, then we can look at it.
It was pretty.
Are you okay with it?
Yeah, it was pretty simple, it wasn't.
I'll double check.
Okay, maybe it's in.
Maybe it's in my, yeah, I don't know what to name it.
All right, so there are, the next two items both involve the necessity for public hearing. So let's talk about them, and then we'll see if August 7th might work for both of them for a public hearing. So one is the dead trees, and, you know, we found out that we need to give folks a heads up about that via public hearing. So it would be included in the letter to them. So that's one public hearing. The other one is the notification that we we haven't really been notified by the state yet, but we've been notified by the Municipal Association, by Senator Waters, that the state will be providing us with additional money for roads. What surprised me was I didn't realize it was going to be in FY17. So it's this fiscal year. And in order to spend the funds, we do need to hold a public hearing. So to say, here's where we're going to spend the dollars that we don't even know.
That we don't know.
We don't know how much it's going to be.
No idea, we haven't been told. But because.
But we do know the things we can't do.
Right, and because these things require at least 7 days' notice, so the thought is, well, do we want to do both of these public hearings on August 7th? Like, start one at 6, one at 6:15?
I'm out of town for work that night, so. But I think you both can do a wonderful job.
You mean the public hearing? The August meeting?
Yes, I won't be there August 7th.
Here's my question.
Yes.
If they don't give us the money, paving stops in October.
Yeah, that's why we, that's exactly.
When do we get the money? And when do we know?
We should know.
Like, if we know we're getting it, we can plan. But if they don't give it to us till November, that does us no good.
We know we're getting it.
Right.
We have no idea how much. We should know at the end of this week.
But we do know we can't use it for paving projects, et cetera,
I did not see that.
I remember the thing I forwarded on.
Yes.
It's in, if you click on the link from the Municipal Association, and it has the bill that passed, it specifically prohibits paving projects or anything related to that that's part of your annual appropriation, budget appropriation.
Well, it has to be something that was not planned for this year. So we have a lot of paving that was not planned for this year.
Okay, you should look at it again, then.
I will.
Specifically.
Yeah, I'm
the way
distressed.
I read it was that it specifically said you could not use it for paving. It has to be for other maintenance issues.
And you forwarded that?
Yeah, it was on.
It was from the Municipal Association.
It was,
well,
it was
sure
one of those Municipal Association bulletins.
Yeah. I didn't see that.
Yeah, I don't remember whatever day we got it on.
So.
It was exciting that we're getting more money. But
well,
we don't know how much, though, because there's only, what was it? And I say only, but it's for every town in the state, and city in the state was 34 million, was that what it was?
Yeah, and you just, whatever portion we get on the full, whatever, we get the percent, same thing. Well, nonetheless, let's schedule a public hearing.
Okay.
Are you sure you don't want to be here?
Well, I just think it's difficult. No, I'll be fine. But
because we do have to hold it ASAP, because even if it's not paving, there are still some things that. It may require paving at the end to finish the project, depending on what it is, right? I mean, at this point, I have no idea, because I just assume that.
Let's see if I'm going to say
July 5th?
August 7th. What do you mean July 5th? August 7th.
No, the one you planted.
Oh, no, it was just last
week. No, it was days ago. It must have been last Friday's newsletter or last Thursday's newsletter.
Maybe it was, yeah. I don't have to do that, just look at what I said.
I mean, it would be on the Municipal Association site.
Yeah. Wednesday, maybe? Yeah, Wednesday. Senate Bill 38, which is now chapter law. It's just like, that's like 227, so it says, we're only investing in the computer, not with my phone. No funds appropriated in paragraph one, that's the money that we would get, shall be used for supplanting locally budgeted and approved funds for road or bridge maintenance or construction. The funds appropriated in paragraph one may be considered unanticipated money under RSA 3195B and may be accepted and expended pursuant to RSA 3195B, subsection Roman 2 through 4, whether or not a town has adopted the provisions of RSA 3195B.
Which we have.
Well, it doesn't matter if we have or not, we can still do it.
Right, we have.
So we can use it this one time, even if we haven't, apparently. It's a nice one. But it's, yeah.
It, what I, are you telling me that you understand from that that we can't do paving?
I'll read it again, maybe I'm just misunderstanding.
I didn't get that, it just said it has to be something that you weren't planning on doing this year.
Right.
Right, well, that's.
You know.
Didn't ask the municipal association, I mean, I'm not the final arbiter of, what was it, chapter law 227, so I'm just saying that's what I, how I read it, so.
Well, I'll definitely check in with them, but I feel quite sure, I mean, I don't have it in front of me, but, it came from, I mean, I had my, what is the email, who's it from? NHMA something?
Yeah, I don't know. It's from Newslink.
Expects the funds to be sent to municipalities by July 28th. Must hold a hearing. This money may not be used to supplant any locally budgeted and approved funds for road or bridge maintenance or construction. So that means you should be careful to document that you are spending this money on new projects that were not included in your 2017 budget. What they're saying is you can't use it to pay for things that you've already been budgeting. So it has to be a new project, which, you know, all we have to do is look at our road surface management system, we've got a ton of them. So I'll double check with the municipal association, but as long as we can prove that it was not part of our 2017 plan, and there certainly is lots of things that were not part of our 2017 plan. It's just that I don't know, you know, is it really Christmas in July, or is it, okay, yeah, isn't that nice, but, you know, I don't know how much it is.
We might want to plan for Plan A at $20,000, Plan B.
Yeah, but you could do that for, I mean, you could do it forever, so we'll just mobilize as soon as we find out, we'll talk to Jeff.
It's supposed to be, what, 5% of?
5% of what we normally get?
Is that what it says, I'm just gonna look at, hold on. What the formula is,
Well, that would be like $3,000.
Right, that's what I'm saying, I wouldn't get too excited, but.
So maybe we could do.
But it's better than.
An overlay of.
I don't know.
Some.
My driveway?
Street, yeah, that's, yeah, if that.
Well, the end street that the gentleman was asking about.
You mean Kewell Drive?
Yeah.
At this point, Jeff says it needs a reclamation, because they really messed it up, but. So $3,000, it has to be more than that.
There'd be potholes.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Well, anyway, so, let's, can we get back to?
Sure.
We'll do, and I'll also check with the municipal association, see if we really have to do a paper, newspaper notice, because it does say that.
For each state highway district in the state, based upon a formula in which half of the amount of funds distributed is based upon on the proportion which the mileage of state maintained class one, class two, class three highways excluding turnpikes in each district as of January 1 of the previous year. There is a total of such mileage in the state and half of the amount of the funds distributed based upon the proportion which the number of state maintained, blah, blah, blah. So it's based on district, so we couldn't possibly tell what Rollins reported.
So, well, we'll just have to wait and see. Okay, so August 7th.
Go for it.
6:15, I mean, August 7th, 6 o'clock for dead trees. 6:15 for the road plan, whatever it is. And then our meeting will just, regular meeting will start afterwards. I mean, is there, I think the dead trees won't take as long, so I, whereas if the road plan, if we do get people, we can bleed into our regular meeting. Does that seem okay with the board?
It's just gonna be you and Jody, so.
Yes.
If you're both okay with it, I'm okay with it.
All right. Okay, well, you still might have some suggestions for this.
I'm not sure, but I have the rest of it for, so it's up to you.
Okay, all right, so I think that was it for those items. The next one is the transfer station damage.
Yes.
To the pavement and some of our cans. Would you like to speak to that, Jody? I think you've been involved, yes.
Yes, so Jeff called me Friday, maybe? Thursday? Thursday it happened, I'm losing dates now. Our Lamprey driver came and took away our MSW can and already made some, I'll call them dig marks in our pavement. There's one major one and two smaller ones. And he once again was rude and quote unquote out of control from what other employees had said. So I emailed the Lamprey.
Yes, thank you for copying us.
And Epping is the only one that has responded with any comments, and Northwood would like to have a meeting set up ASAP as well, and I haven't heard back from everybody.
Right. So, but you're hoping to have a special meeting, because when is the next?
They won't meet again until the fall for the next budget. They only meet twice or three times a year.
All right, so a special meeting and.
Right. Okay. So, and we'll look into our contract with Waste Management on if Shipyard can haul our stuff for us. Like, are we bound by that contract to only have to go to Waste Management? Because it doesn't matter who delivers it, it matters where it goes. So.
Right, but I thought we were in a truck cooperative.
We are in a truck cooperative.
So aren't we bound then to have the truck cooperative haul our carbon?
That's what I got to figure out in our contract.
Okay.
And that's one of the conversations I wanted to have. This pavement is only 5 days old. And not only is our pavement ruined, he's also, from what I was told, grinding gears, and Epping even attested to that as well, that he beats on the truck. And the truck that we paid for is not being maintained, so I got to find out who's maintaining it, how often is it being washed, how often is the inside being vacuumed, how often is the oil being changed.
Yeah, I mean, do you think, that's an interesting question. I mean, is it supposed to be that driver's responsibility?
That's what
or is there somebody else in the pull-off?
That's what I have to find out. From what I understand, Jay from Madbury was always the person that spoke for the driver. So, and we're not the only town with the same concerns.
Yeah.
So we asked them to haul on a certain day. He didn't come. He wasn't going to come. So we have to have Shipyard move one of the cans. Now, Shipyard's been in and out a couple of times. They haven't damaged anything. So.
And cement trucks, apparently, too, Jeff said. They come into Portsmouth.
Yeah.
So I talked to him today.
What happens with the trucks that haul the cans is they have to dip down in those wheels at the bottom, the rollers at the bottom, and if you ding them down hard enough, you're going to lift up the back, the front end of your truck. And so, there's no need of that on the truck.
Mm-hmm.
So, I guess that happens quite often. So.
Oh, well, it's
so management.
It's distressing.
Yeah.
All right, well, thank you for that.
The fellow, gentleman from Epping suggested, well, you know, it's been really hot, and maybe it wasn't really their fault, you know. So I asked Jeff today, I had called him for something else, and he was here, and says, well, let me ask him. And he said, well, no, there had been other trucks coming, because Shipyard had to come in, and we had cement trucks in, and they didn't do any of that damage, it was when he dropped the fork thing to pull, whatever, to pull the thing up, he damaged the pavement, so.
And apparently, it's been an ongoing issue with spike marks in our cans.
Yeah.
And spike marks are when the claws that grab the rollers pull up, if you don't line up perfectly, you're gonna ding your can. Well, some of the ding marks are way up here. So, and they puncture the cans, and that's where the repair comes in. And one of the cans, the arm needs to be repaired, and it needs to be welded back down as well. I forwarded you those pictures, correct?
Yes, yes, not that I processed them closely, but thank you, it's still good to be kept in the loop, so I appreciate it.
Okay.
It's distressing, yes, but thank you for carrying the ball on this and continuing to pursue. Did you have any other comments?
No, it's just very disconcerting.
Yes, of course.
And thank you for looking at it.
Yeah.
Okay, so.
The kids in the dump looks really nice. They were with me.
Excellent. Our town treasurer thought it looked pretty good.
Yeah.
All right, town administration, project updates. So, we are on the verge of starting our culvert projects, and the next step is the contract agreement with the first change order, and to review, the contract is written with for the full, whatever it is, $271,000, let me get the cost here, $279,103. So that was the bid price. The change order is to remove Pine Street, which everyone feels is a temporary change order. And as soon as we get the final permit from the Army Corps of Engineer on Pine Street, we'll do another change order to bring Pine Street back in. So Steve Roberts was here this morning, he reviewed the contract and is ready to sign. You know, we have to send to USDA contract, change order, the fact that our attorney is attesting that, you know, we have the right to enter into this contract, that he's examined it, he's examined the bonds, he was here today, saw the bonds. I sent the contract to the board, I think last Thursday, whatever, another link again today. Did you have any questions about this?
All right, I'll check it out.
Okay.
No, thank you very much.
When do we think the Corps will have a permit back? Do they anticipate how long it will take?
Well, Hoyt Tanner thought it should be no problem. So, you know, the current schedule, and Parker's coming tomorrow to meet with Jeff and Caroline and I. Okay. Meet with Jeff, Caroline, and me. That's the object of the presentation.
Right. I understand. Yeah. I know.
To just kind of review the first start of the mobilization, the first mobilization. So the plan is to start with Willie Street. And as soon as we're finalized, I'll alert the Willie Street folks, you know, the school and Camp Raleigh and that sort of thing, and Dick, well, that's the school. And then it's the culvert, the drain pipe in the lower mills. So that's the sort of the current schedule. You know, Jeff is gearing up to be there every day to do his little thingy. I spoke with Boyle Tanner about two things. It would be helpful if perhaps somebody could come the first day just to make sure that everything is fine with the process that Jeff is using. And then we're going to need somebody for the 2 weeks that Jeff is going to be away. So I haven't heard from them. I assume they're trying to figure this out, and I'm not going to panic just yet.
You haven't heard from Coyle and Camp?
No, okay. I've not. I talked to USDA, and because I said, look, we could need a really, we're going to need a fast turnaround. We're going to send you tomorrow, you know, because the board is looking at the stuff tonight. So hopefully, I'm going to send you tomorrow a signed contract by us and Parker, who's coming tomorrow, a signed change order by us and Parker, who's coming tomorrow, Steve Roberts' certification of review and blah, 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 and they say they also want the certificate of insurance, which we have, they want the bonds, which we've got scanned, so we'll send them all that stuff. If they can give us a quick turnaround, then we can issue the notice to proceed, which I guess is the legal way to say, okay, you could now start working. So what I would like the board to consider is the contract, which we have in front of us, the change order, which we have in front of us, and then authorization to sign the notice to proceed if the USDA tells us that yes, we can issue that. Because that, you know, he's gonna start at the end of this week, which is what he had left Parker, which is what he last said, I don't know, is it Thursday, is it Friday? I don't know, then we'll need to try to get the turnaround on this. So that's.
Well, three signs or just you?
That's a good question. I'm looking at the contract. Owner, let's see. In witness whereof, owner and contractor have signed this agreement will be effective on, which is the effective date of the contract, it's just owner.
Just you?
Yes.
I'm gonna move that we sign a contract, change order, and a notice to proceed.
Can we do them one at a time?
I'll move that we sign the contract.
Okay. All right, it's an agreement between us and Parker and Daughters, and I'm gonna go just to make sure that there's anything here. All right, so in witness, who is the witness? Yeah, I think it doesn't say it has to be a notary or JP, so. All right, witness whereof, owner and contractor have signed this agreement. This agreement will be on, effective on, I'm gonna say today, what is today?
24.
Okay, which is the effective date of the contract, so owner is the town of Rollinsford. And I'm gonna sign under the by.
The attest needs a title.
Thank you, okay, let me read to you the change order so that we know what it is that we're going to sign. So thank you. So here's the description. The contract is modified as follows upon execution of this change order. New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services issued a wetlands permit for the Pine Street culvert on June 15th, 2017. As of June 15th, 2017, the project is being reviewed by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineer for possible approval under the Army Corps New Hampshire State Programmatic General Permit. This change order is being issued to temporarily remove Pine Street culvert work to allow the contractor to proceed with the other culvert projects while waiting for issuance of Army Corps programmatic permit. The contractor has agreed to hold the bid price of $91,231 for the Pine Street culvert for 30 days. This amount will be added back into the contract once the Army Corps permit is received. So that's what it says. So the original contract price, right here, is $279,103. Which is the contract price prior to this change order. The decrease of this change order is $91,231. So the contract price incorporating the change order is $187,872.
So moved.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
So I'm going to sign the change order as owner. The USDA will also have to sign this through the funding agency. And the contract will sign, I don't know, it says engineer here, but I'm not sure that we need an engineer. I'll check with USDA about that. There's no change in the contract time, so this thing is, doesn't change. All right, thank you. So we've got the agreement and we have the change order number one. So once the USDA approves all of what we just did, then we will issue a notice to proceed, which I suspect one of us will need to sign. So what I'm looking for is a motion that says, given that the USDA has approved the contract, the change order number one, that you authorize me or one of us, maybe probably any one of us, to sign the notice to proceed.
Okay, I'll move that. We authorize one of the members of the Board of Selectmen, Select Board, to sign the notice to proceed and approval is given by the Army, by the United States Department of Agriculture.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
I couldn't say USDA.
No, that was quite formal.
I didn't mean to, it just bubbled up, sorry.
All right, so, excellent. So again, Parker and Daughters will be here tomorrow afternoon with your local project management team, which is Jim, Caroline, and me. All right, now I'll keep you posted.
All right.
As to what is happening. Okay, next on the agenda. Oh, Caroline is, that's just there. Caroline is working on a USDA compliance report that we have to hand in about ethnicity of our staff, gender and ethnicity, et cetera, et cetera. So that's just so we don't lose sight of it. The other thing to tell you about the project update is that Caroline and I met with the treasurer on last week to review our process of how we're going to transfer money. So all of our funds, the two municipal bond bank bonds and the short-term loan from Kennebunk are in PDIP accounts, in separate PDIP accounts. Beverly has gotten online access, so she's all set to make the transfer.
Mm-hmm.
We developed a very simple fund transfer request form, sort of like the cash reimbursement, you know, that requisition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so we will submit that to Beverly with the appropriate invoices when we ask for a transfer. And then she'll move the funds from, let's say, probably the first one will be the transfer station, because we're really, you know, once we get the invoices, I think our cash flow, we talked about cash flow with the two, our cash flow is such that we can probably wait till we get all of the transfer station invoices and have just one transfer. You know, hand it to Beverly, she'll put it in the general fund and in our Citizens Bank, not necessarily in the general fund, but in the Citizens Bank account. So that's the process.
Mm-hmm.
Any questions on that? All right. Quarterly budget. All right. Here are your copies of the, I already gave you your.
Yep.
Yes, okay. Perfect. And here's the, kind of like the summary. My copy. Yes, that's yours. I printed it in draft mode, so the colors didn't print, and it already came out when I saw it, so I did not reprint it. So if you're looking at if you're orienting yourself, in column H is the 2017 budget as we look forward from town meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
In column I are any changes that I'm recommending for the board to consider budget changes in order to manage the overruns in the highway department because of the winter and in the maintenance to the town hall because of the circulator pumps and the sprinklers and assorted other things. So for example, and those changes, I think you can see in, it's just a very slight, so any cell that's like that has had a budget change. So in the executive session, I'm recommending $1,000 come out of IT and that's going to the town hall maintenance and contingency. I took virtually everything out of there and brought it into the highway department. That's where contingency is. So, given that, the other thing is the percentages, you know, the percentages spent? It is, the percentage at the very, very bottom of the report is correct. As far as total expenses, we're 43.7% of the budget. But I noticed after I printed it that in some of the sections, I didn't change the formula for calculating the percentage spent. So, for example, if you look at the executive session, I don't know what you have, but it's 47.9% expended. Okay, so I didn't change on that. There may be some where there was a slight difference to the percent expended. So, you know, unless you have particular questions, if you look at the...
This is mine, but on line 28, the advertising?
Yes.
We're going to go over on that, because we have to have those two hearings now, plus whatever else comes up in the fall.
Yes, but the...
And it's minor, but...
The level of which is, yeah.
Yeah.
So, I think that one doesn't... I'm not particularly concerned about that. And I am going to check with the Municipal Association to make sure that we have to notice it in a newspaper. Because that's what gets expensive,
yeah.
Right? So, I mean, it's what the RSA said, but maybe there's another RSA somewhere. I know they were working on trying to make electronic notifications sort of equivalent. So, bless you. In the next section, I see I lost my section headings because I was trying to keep it printing to one page. But the next one is the town clerk, and that we're, you know, 51%, not an issue. The financial administration, we're at 50%, so everything's fine there. The reval is at 17.5%, because a number of, we only have one sort of monthly bill. It's the appraisal bill. The mapping and the information system license comes in at the end of the year in one lump sum. So the fact that we've only spent 17% doesn't mean there's going to be money left over there. And then the personnel administration, which is section 62 to 68, the reason it is expended to such a degree is because we pay all of the workers' compensation at once. So. Explains that. Planning is not in any particular problem. And then if you get to the buildings, which is starts at row 79, now the one cell in here that's gotten a shot of money is the town hall maintenance. And so the budget's been increased to $19,941. And that should, and we've already spent $15,468. So the balance should cover the mold maintenance, which is $3,000, I think, plus any, like, for example, the repair work that Bob mentioned to us this evening. Cemeteries, insurance, we've paid it all. We've paid our dues for our regional associations. In the police budget, thanks to Chief Ducharme, I'm recommending we take $5,000 out of patrol officer 3, which is 118, and that went up to the town hall maintenance. And even with that, he's at 44% of his budget. Fire, which starts at 158, is at 30%. Police inspector is close to 50%. The highway department is the most changed. And Caroline worked with Jeff to make some changes that he was recommending. So the increases are to winter help and associated payroll taxes in order to deal with that. He wanted an increase in safety equipment. He thought the telephone, row 202, the telephone line had been over budgeted, so we grabbed a little money from there. He thought equipment he was not going to need all of the $4,000, so we got a couple of thousand from there. vehicle repair maintenance is out of this world. It's, you know, the issues with the backhoe and then the accidents that we had to pay out. And depending on, you know, what happens in the subsequent weeks, I mean, we can see how that reimbursable account up, up at the top, if there's still money in there, we might be able to move some down here as well. Vehicle fuel, we increased by 500. Street sweeping, we reduced it to the cost because we're not doing anything more with that this year. Salt got increased by 4,000. Roadside mowing got increased by the contract amount. And so, so as it stands right now, he's at, you know, let's say 40% of the revised budget, but it's an increased budget and it, the expenses are still to come, you know, as we resume winter. Nothing, street lighting is at like 50%. Transfer station, you know, there could be some money here, but there's also going to be some incidental expenses associated with the improvements we just did, like he wants to put a fence, a railing back in, on top of the recycle thing. He had to, he did some, gonna forget exactly, but he did something else that required some, like about $400 or $500. So that will come out of the maintenance line here, but I think the transfer station is going to be fine overall. Yeah, it's going to be able to manage whatever, even if there is a slight overage in the maintenance line. Because as soon as the... Yes, so we'll enjoy some savings in the hauling. How much, we're not sure, but certainly we'll have some savings there as well. The emergency management section, we're going to start to see some expenses now because of the FEMA, I mean the Homeland Security things that, Chief Duchamp's brought to us. The health, oh, there's really just the health officer line that's not expended. The animal control officer is over budget, you know, it kind of oscillates depending on what happens, so it doesn't mean that we'll be over budget at the end of the year, but right now it is. Welfare is doing very well, as you can see. And summer rec, we won't know until we start to get...
4 more weeks.
4 more weeks, yeah. And so because we didn't know where we were going to put the budget, we put the budget all in one line, so... some of the expenses that we are starting to get that we're putting in the line where it should be are causing those huge percentage, you know, so it's just a mathematical oddity based on the fact that it's only a dollar budget. Library is fine and I don't see any other issues. So so the total, if you look down at the bottom, we've expended 43.7% of the budget. Then what you see underneath are our carry forwards from FY16. So those lines from the two POs, one was for Steve Height, and the other was for the steeple, the roofing. And so if you look on page 54 of your town report, you can see where we've carried forward that. So this is, these are the amounts that we've carried forward, 6893 for town hall maintenance, and 9,700 for professional services, so that's Steve's. And then the column J is the expense to date. So we totally spent out the roofing, steeple roof, and we still have a little bit of money left from Steve Height, and we did get I believe it's a final invoice in July, so it will come out of that. So, so that's expenses. Any questions on that? Comments? Capital items. We don't have many expenses that have hit through now. We've had some for town hall drainage and for the rebuild. But through June, that was all we had. And then the revenue, I think is looking decent. If you look at revenue from taxes, we don't have the inventory fully recorded yet, because I think it's too soon, I think it happens later in the year or something, or whatever, but other than that, I mean, still remains at 40%. Permits are, the vehicles are up in row 18. In row 19, the surcharge, it really didn't start until June, and we're hoping it gets started in April, but there were various reasons why it took a little bit of time. Our building permits are almost at 50%, not quite. So overall, our permits and fees are, you know, almost 56%. The revenue from the state, we really don't get until, the bulk of it, until the end of the year. So that's when we get the road and meals tax. Apparently, we get some highway, because we recorded the 22,000, but we also get another, the rest of it, like, in December. None of our grant money is yet in, although the NRRA should have come in, so I don't see it recorded here yet.
Yeah, that came in months ago.
Oh, maybe it's in another line. We could have put it in the transfer station line, I'm not sure. Charge for services is almost 50%. Miscellaneous is over 50%. One of the things that I've noticed is, if you look at row 63, the hydro is, you know, we had budgeted 35,000 for the entire year. So I don't know, I don't really know what the flow of money, no pun intended, of course, happens. You know, I don't know whether it oscillates from season to season. It might. So I don't know whether we normally get more than half through, from January through June. I really don't know. So, but anyway, we do have more than half for the hydro. So if it holds true, that will be a nice little bonus. And we, if you look in the interfund operating transfers, this is the money that we asked the trustees to transfer to us for the reval, for which we had the contract, and the culprits, which we had the task order. So that was $120,500. Then under other financing, you'll see the proceeds from the financing, from our municipal budget bonds and the short-term loan. So that's the revenue. And if you look at the notes, I don't know if there's anything here that I haven't already said. Questions?
No, thank you.
Jody?
Okay.
No.
I'm just concerned with moving all almost all contingency open right now. But.
Thank you.
We have to cover it somehow, right?
Right.
Chinburg development. This was the question of the driveway ramps, and we asked our building inspector, code enforcement officer, to look into it. And he said that they're a temporary adjustment because there's just a binder coat on the road right now, and once the final coat is put on, the ramps will be removed. So it's just for the convenience of the residents right now. Is that?
We're not plowing it then.
No, we don't plow. It's on our road.
Right.
So by the time it becomes, by the time it's presented to the town for approval, they'll be removed.
Fine.
Okay. Old Mill Lane Bridge is, we don't lose sight of it. Fuel contract. So there was emails going back and forth, and Townsend has given us 18 cents over RAF, which is what it was last year. So is there a contract in there?
There is.
Oh, excellent.
I can remember where it was.
So we have a fixed price of propane at $1.899 per gallon. A fuel oil, 18 cents over cost. Road diesel, 18 cents over cost. And the service pricing is the same, $99 per hour. So the contract is good for July through next April. And given that, is there a motion to accept this contract from Townsend Energy?
So.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. I guess we're all gonna sign it, actually.
We used to be excited when it was 25 cents over RAF, so it's getting better.
I think this is what it was last year, too.
I like how you have to sign the bond from your PA, but we all have to sign Townsend Energy.
Right.
There doesn't seem to be a,
Rhyme or
law, yes, exactly, right. Oh, $3 million? Yeah, I just, I had signed it. 2,000? Yeah, let's have everybody sign it. Believe me, that one USDA signature, though, is certified by a lawyer, is like, you know, it's... Goodness. Michael, I can almost read that.
I know, right?
Yeah.
Almost.
Almost. All right, thank you very much. You will alert the school district that we have done this so that they can also receive the same offer. All right. Rec committee, was there anything you wanted to say about the rec committee?
Nothing major, just little bumps and stuff.
Yeah, okay.
Basic. They were supposed to be paving this week, so they planned field trips for all week, but rain's in our forecast, so they stay in today, and
oh,
I don't know if they're going to be able to pave this week, but they have plans to go on field trips all week to stay out of their way.
Okay.
So if it gets postponed to next week, are they going to try to do the same thing?
Yeah, so Brittany's working with Kate to find, and Richard to find out.
Yeah.
When they have equipment already there,
yeah.
But they said it was going to take 3 days. They can't pave in the rain, and forecast is calling for more rain. So,
yep. All right.
So whenever they're ready to leave.
Okay. All right. Utility assessment method. Give me a minute. I know I asked Caroline to put this up. Thank you, Jody.
You're welcome.
That's right. It's the telephone.
That's how we are.
So, we really should read this, and I'm never good at reading at a meeting. So, we'll scan this, put it up on the web, yes, and send it, give you the link. Please read it, we'll keep it on, we'll make the, they want to know ASAP if we don't agree with how they're going to manage it. And I can't even give you an executive summary, I mean, that's just what they want us to do, but I don't know what they're, how they're changing, what they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
So, avatar.
Yeah, I briefly read it. It's because of the new legislation on how they're counting poles.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the depreciation of the poles on the 40-year whatever spreadsheet that he created.
I did ask Caroline, well, I said, look, I'm going to go right to the bottom line. Is the assessed value more or less for us? And it's actually a little more. So I said, well, okay, that
would... change the formula again, but remember...
Yeah, but they could be sued.
They got sued.
Yeah, we could, so same thing could happen. So we'll scan this, put it up, and take a look at it. We'll leave it on the agenda for next week. Anything on the historical committee non-lapsing account, Mike?
Meeting tomorrow.
Okay. All right, I wanted to have a conversation. I know our meeting didn't last very long last week, and... I think there are clear advantages to not meeting every Monday as far as, you know, sort of recruiting people and able people who might want to serve on a select board and being more leadership and that sort of thing. So if the board is willing, I'd like to have a conversation about, well, what would stop us from doing that? I'm not looking for solutions now, I'm just saying, what are the things we have to consider? And first of all, I mean, are you interested in pursuing that idea? Just even like talking through some of the issues, or not?
Depends on the month. So there are certain times of year we should be meeting twice a week. And there are certain times of the year that every other week looks us.
I mean, I think budget season,
Yeah.
it would probably be very difficult to meet twice a month, I would think.
Well, one of the things that could happen is you'd have a regular board meeting twice a month, and then you'd have, you could do a budget workshop.
Workshop on those days?
Yeah.
You're not saying.
For those.
We're still gonna probably be busy every week, it's just not the full board meeting as a board.
But it'd be for those times when we have particular needs. So, all right, so.
I mean, I would think there are certain times of the year when we don't meet on holidays now, right? So bear with me, it's a scattered thought. A backup. The department heads would need to plan accordingly, right? They would have to get used to this new system, but they have to do that anyways, when we have holidays, right? So that would be my main concern, is that, will we be able to act in a timely manner for a department head when they need things? Would be my main concern.
Yeah, like this year, Christmas is Monday, and New Year's Day is Monday. So the last time they would see us is December 18th.
Yeah.
Well, clearly, I mean, around that particular Thanksgiving and Christmas, we would need to look at what the calendar says, right? One thing I thought of is certificate of occupancy. I mean, people like those sign right away, so we need to consider process for that.
But I think this is a laudable goal, but I think towns that are able to do this have a different level of administrative support than our town does not have. So they have either a town administrator or a town manager system where.
So do you think this is the cart before the horse?
I think so. Like the town of Salem meets, I think they meet once a month? I was talking about the selectmen, maybe it's twice a month. You think, oh my God, how's a town like Salem, which is really a city? I mean, when you think about it, the population, it's not all that. But because they have full-time departments it's just run like a city, they have full-time departments and they have an administrator. So yeah, the select board can have the luxury of only meeting once a month or twice a month. But they do much more, it's much more administrative than that simply they just sign off on big picture things. We sign off on minor things, little picture things, very little picture things in some cases, right? So I'd love to be able to only meet twice a month, I just don't think it's practical right now. Trust me, I would love to do that, but
It's just sometimes, you see an elephant and you think, oh, well, forget it, But sometimes if you see the elephant and you just do one bite at a time.
Let's work through it.
So the first thing, so I've already got, you've got department heads.
But I see further down on the agenda.
Occupancy. Well, yes, I have another
order,
thing. Yes.
So, I mean, I don't know.
Yeah.
But if you want to know this first blush.
Cart before the horse.
I think so.
That's fair. Alright, so we'll let that.
We shouldn't work on the horse.
Percolate for a bit and see if we come up with any further wisdom on that. Policies and procedures. So, welfare, we're going to meet, is it next week?
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll meet to start work on the first section of welfare next Monday. So, purchase orders. So, it has occurred to me that we have provided department heads with a credit card that allows them to go up to $200. So even though we don't have like the entire purchasing policy completely ironed out, it's mostly just because of the reporting aspect. I think we generally agreed on the thresholds and stuff. But is there any reason why we couldn't just change the limit of a purchase order to $200, which is what we're giving them to be able to get with a credit card?
The only thing, no, I don't see a problem with it. what I see as the problem is that they're not actually, as far as I know, aren't using the credit card as much as they probably should be or could be. And we still see an awful lot of, I mean, not this week, but in the last few weeks, we've seen an awful lot of small purchase orders, right? So.
Right, but there's credit, and there's a credit card.
No, that's not to say this doesn't have merit, I'm just, it's part of the problem.
So how is that, how is it related, I guess, how is it related? I mean.
Well, we're still making multiple trips. I have two trips to Tri-City Masonry 2 days apart, or a day apart. For $152 and $152. And I'm assuming to keep it underneath that line item.
Well, that's against the policy, if that's really what happened, can I see that for a minute?
Was that what the credit, that what the credit card was used?
Yeah. And then back to back, some on another, and but I don't see if they want that credit.
Well, is it possible that that's all our truck held?
What is, I don't know what the material of what we're going to get.
That's the problem with this.
Can you point it out?
Doesn't say, right, it just says.
It just says Tri-City Masonry, so I have the full, the bill.
I mean, it could have been materials that have a shelf life, I mean, I don't know. Or that they could, they need to use it one day and then you're, I don't know, I don't know what it is, so. If it's mortar or something, like mixed, I don't know, that doesn't make sense to me, but it would have delivered it, but.
So let's make note of that.
Who knows?
But they, the credit card is not supposed to be used for like ticket splitting, you can't.
Right.
No.
Right, and then on the third, we went to Home Depot twice for $60 and $35.
How is that different from what was normally happening anyway? I mean, I'm not saying that that's a good practice, but that that's not what we're trying to answer by increasing the purchase order limit to $200.
Yep.
Right?
Yep. That's a, okay, that'll be a good discussion.
We're bringing up other problems at all.
Right.
Yeah, so I mean, that's a good discussion, but that, I think it's just different from.
I got you.
Do you want to increase the purchase order ceiling to 200 or greater than?
Why don't you tell us why you think we should?
Just for consistency, I mean, you're giving a department head the ability to buy something for $200 with a credit card, so why do they have to fill out, and we got one from Chief Ducharme, the way, a purchase order for, I don't know, $79 or something. So it's time to process, it's, you know, we know we want to increase that threshold when we have the full-fledged policy, so does it make sense from a consistency point of view to just say, okay, you're in charge of your budget, these are expenses below, the individual expenses, $200 or below, and for those, we don't need to see the purchase order. I mean, that's what I'm wanting us to think about.
That's fine, as long as I see the receipts, like this, I guess I still want to see receipts. And I guess
of all purchases?
I guess I'd have to come in not during a meeting, like, we have Amazon Prime membership, $99.
Did you see my note?
Did you leave a note? Follow up on Prime membership.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know what that's all about.
Right.
So, I don't know whether it's a mistake or what, so yes, we're following up on that.
Something on Black Debt Friday.
So, I don't have a problem with them, because I guess we still have to just double check the bills.
Well, Caroline, I don't.
Right, but let's take something off of her plate, she has enough.
No, no, she does that as a matter of course. I mean, this, even if the purchase order is $70, I mean, she's still.
Right,
she's
still our job. We're elected to watch the budget. Now, if I have no way to know what this means, I should have access to this.
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel that you've had access to the less than $50 purchase orders? The thing, less than $50 purchases, so right now, they haven't had to come to us for purchases less than $50.
I should know where this is. I should be able to access this.
The credit card in particular.
And the receipts.
The credit card we're going to see every week.
Right, and the receipts that go with it.
So I know what was actually purchased.
That was the whole point of the credit card.
Yeah, I agree with you.
until we know this is flowing well.
That's what we thought was gonna happen. I thought it was gonna happen.
So.
And not to second guess or, you know, undermine or, it's just a second set of eyes.
I mean, I can sit here and come up with reasons why we might have gotten a prime membership for shipping purposes, taking free shipping, I get, but I don't really know that for a fact, because I'm just making it up. I mean, that's why I did it at home, but that doesn't mean, it could have been a mistake too. I mean, I will admit, I have used my P card for work, because it looked just like one of my personal cards. I used it once and went, oh crap, that's my work card. But then I just had to write a check right away and send it to our accountant.
No, that is a violation.
Yeah, well, it wasn't done intentionally, and they understood that, and I sent them a check that day. So I get, that happens. I mean, I'm not the only person in my organization who's done that, so, and that happens in other places, so. Maybe it was that. It could be, but we don't know, because we don't have anything to go with it, so I would put it on.
It raised a big question in my mind, so.
Yeah, because we still ended up going to Walmart and the paint store. So what did we buy on Amazon?
I don't know. If that was supposed to help with procurement, yeah, but certainly not.
I don't know. I mean, it's a question, so.
You have to know what you can ask carefully.
So I'm fine with the purchase orders going up to 200, but we still have to have access as to what they're spending it on.
Yeah.
And when I get to these purchase orders, I'll tell you why.
So, all right, but can you explain, when you say access, do you mean just you would be able to come in and take a look, or you want them at the meeting, or what?
Both. Well, not both, but, you know, if I want to come in, I should, A, know where they are.
Absolutely.
B, not to hinder her day.
Yeah.
Like, I should know where the Home
where
Depot.
Where to find them.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
So let me run that by Caroline.
Yeah.
And so let's hold
like
off
last
on that.
I knew, I think I know where they are, but in case things got moved, you know, if they moved, let us know.
I have no idea where they were, but are, to be honest with you, but I thought that they were going to be in a folder for us with the credit card statement every month. So we could review them. Honestly, I thought that's what we were.
You know, I didn't remind Caroline because I thought it was just the credit card statement.
The statement would be fine if it actually said what we bought, but it doesn't, right?
Well,
so,
it does. I mean, you know,
it just says
where we bought it. So I mean,
where does it tell you what you bought?
But it's, you know, I really did think we were going to have the receipts kept monthly until
then,
we got comfortable enough where we understood that we could just look at that and kind of decipher it. So.
Right, like the Tri-City Masonry. Like, I can tell you if the blocks, he had to go back twice because the blocks won't only fit in the truck. Or.
That makes sense.
All right, so I've got a note to mention that to Caroline that you guys want her to see the receipts for the credit card as well.
I think you get the highlight, so thank you.
All right, so let's. We'll visit this again. I'll meet with Caroline and get some more information from her, and we'll come back and talk about how to set up.
Perfect. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. And welfare, we said we're going to meet next month. So now we're at standing items for town administration. Michael, what have you been up to?
Go. We already talked about our tour. I was blown away by this, and so. The one thing that I thought was really exciting, I asked the engineer what the process was like to get approval from the town. And he said, well, the first time Farmington tried, 3 or 5 years ago, something like that, it didn't pass. And then they went to this method with the design build, and there was a much more interactive process with the public. The contractors are available for multiple meetings, you know, much like school went through. I mean, they had that it passed the first year they attempted this way of doing it. So I thought that was encouraging, only because people were kept so informed, so, and they felt like they were part of the process, which I thought was encouraging. But I was very impressed by it. Very impressed. It was nice because we were taken around by two of the police officers, and so we could ask very candid questions about what they liked and what they didn't like about it. The things they didn't like about it weren't because of the builders or the way the builders built what it was designed. There was just some flow issues in the way that the police actually designed it. And the way they placed them in their offices and things, they wished they had done it slightly different. That's not the...
That's always the case.
That's not the builder, right?
Yeah.
That was the only complaint. They were,
sure.
They were very happy with the end product, though. So I thought that was encouraging, too. And the fire on the other side said similar things, so... tomorrow night, the historical committee. I don't think I've got anything else this week. Check my calendar, but I think I did.
Sheriff on the meeting tomorrow night, or Wednesday night at 6 at the library in Centerbrook, and recreating at the meeting on the 6th, which is a Sunday night at 7.
All right. So you're still on the sheriff on board?
Yes.
Were we unable to get...
No, we have two people.
Oh, okay.
At the bathroom.
Okay, so there's a community member as well as a board member that I'm...
There's two people.
From Rollinsford?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's excellent. And as far as my schedule goes, we're meeting with Parker and Daughters tomorrow afternoon. And as soon as we get some sort of specificity on when we think the project will start, we'll put something up on the website and we'll alert by mail the appropriate people that who have been to the reconstruction meeting and that sort of thing. Okay, that's for standing items, for schedules. So now we're at building permits.
What about the F's earlier? Are any of the trees that fell down on Bear Road Green?
I think, I think they are, but I don't know for sure.
So that'll save us some money?
Right.
Could.
Yay.
I'll go through these.
No one's hurt. One other item with regard to our schedule is we do have a non-public at the end. It's an exemption for, it's an elderly exemption. So when we get there, it'll be the last item, and we'll just, the board will stay, and the rest of you can go on home.
The first item we have tonight is for really a stamp, but it's a sewage disposal system that Mr. Clark has reviewed. It's for, it says Wentworth Street, Lot 9. So we must not have an actual number yet. And the next one we have, same thing, sewage disposal system for 53 Rollins Road, also reviewed by Mr. Clark. So, waiting for you to stand. The first building permit, though, of the evening is 2017-063. 14 Turgeon Way is a demolition permit. They are taking down 8x14 lean-to. Has been reviewed by Mr. Clark with a $25 administrative fee. We'll get until the end of the year and knock it down. And hopefully, Avatar will make note of that. Permit number 2017-082. 195 Goodwin Road. They are doing a solar array. Has been approved by Mr. Clark. Reviewed rather by Mr. Clark, approved by us. $175 fee. And the specs are, it's on the roof. Right, if you want to see it. I think those panels. Good for that. Becoming more and more popular.
Mm-hmm. Sign up for it.
And that's it for tonight. And let's go.
I'm good.
Yeah, don't got more to sign. I'll take a sip of water. You'd have to stretch to get to
it. A year of practice.
Yeah, I think so.
Well, I purchase orders. Purchase order 972, motion to move purchase order 972 to CED Electric. And as I quote, "electrical stuff for transfer station."
That was the other thing that I was trying to remember.
For $481.68.
And that should come out of the transfer station maintenance line, so we should put that there.
So we put it under highway.
Oh, yeah, he's highway, but it's, it should be the transfer station.
He was seconding it, right, so we can talk, I'll second it, so we can talk.
Okay, Michael seconded it.
So what is this, say it again, what is it for?
You know, the conduit between the,
So you know what it actually is for, that's not what it says on the thing, it's just the stuff for the.
Yeah, no, well, I couldn't tell you.
I can read it off.
Yeah, I couldn't tell you more specifically, but it has to do with the conduit between the.
Oh, is there a list?
To the new compactor.
Yeah.
Oh, it's stuff is listed for it, too, okay, I'm okay with that.
Yeah, so there is an invoice, from them, and it's for two-inch conduit, the elbows, the PVC elbows, because the piping has to go.
He actually laid it, he actually, Jeff did the work.
Right, it's just the materials, I got you.
Materials, yeah.
I understand a lot more now.
Okay, so I've got a first and a second, I'll call the question, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Would you want to see?
Oh, I know, I read what it is now, just stuff for electrical stuff doesn't tell me much,
I just thought it was cute. All right, move to accept purchase order 969 to Haley Door Company under Highway Department, various issues with garage door at Highway Department, for a total of $942.50.
Second. Yeah, are we aware of door problems at the?
Well, that's where I was gonna ask you, because I'm thinking my old age memories started kicking faster.
No.
It could have been like the fire department.
On May 18th.
Oh.
We troubleshot the garage door at the shop. The door was opening and closing all by itself. The police department was called in the middle of the night. On May 23rd, we programmed and delivered the remote. We spent 1.75 hours at $110 an hour, per hour, and another hour at $192. We have enclosed a copy of our service repair work order. We replaced three sets of commercial safety sensors, photo eyes on three of the shop garage doors, $225 per set, includes labor and shipping at $675.
So we have a maintenance contract with them for our doors. Remember, this is the company that we did, so.
Okay.
But I'm just surprised, unless, you know, unless
all
my memory.
All three of us are not remembering, so I think we didn't know.
So should we, do we want to talk to Jeff first about what's going on with the doors, or?
Yes, because this is a service order in Jeff's, their writing, from May 7th. The garage door opened and closed all by itself.
I just don't remember this.
Mm-hmm.
So why don't we hold off and talk to Jeff about this?
Do we have it?
As we just look at our budget.
Well,
we took 2,000 out of it, but
yeah.
There's still, let's look quickly. Has a budget of $4,500. We didn't change the budget
for that one.
For that one.
Okay.
And it spent $1,158. So there's a balance of $3,300.
Well, we need to pay the bill, right? But we also I want to get a little more background.
Yeah. I mean, I know we do have to pay the bill, but I mean, this is from May.
I can wait a week, so. All right. I would wait a week.
Okay.
So I'm going to just send my second.
Well, no.
Yeah.
I see that one.
Yeah.
Okay.
The whole bill.
I'll just put a note at Jeff's.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay. Move to accept purchase order 971 to Brock Industries for 2.2 tons of asphalt for potholes, for a total of $149.60.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 This one or the bubble one?
This one.
With the button just to. For bubbles? Mike, do you wanna look at legal while she's doing that?
Sure.
Okay, move to accept purchase order 973 to AAA fence. Fence for transfer station. This is a safety fence that will be placed by the recyclables for $1,093.
Okay, I'll second for purposes of discussion.
So this is the fence that will go on the top in front of the recycle place?
Didn't we have one there already? Is it the same place? I'm just trying to think of that, I'm not.
It's the same place.
Not accusatory, I'm wondering if it's.
You can't use the same fencing apparently.
Reinstall existing rail.
Well, because it was, they were buried in, it was the old stuff, and the old stuff's not there.
Reinstall existing rail on retaining wall with some new fence rails and posts added.
So they are using pieces of it, of the old one.
Well, Jeff explained this to me, and what, the fence that's saved, that is saved.
Yes.
He wants to replace.
Say that again.
There's still fencing there where the dumpster is.
Right.
But where the recyclables were, they had to take that part down to work on that retaining wall.
Right.
He wants to fix all of it to make it look nice.
Okay.
So I'm not okay with replacing what's already there when we're so tight on our budget right now. I understand that we have to replace the safety guard of the dumpster.
Right.
But I'm not okay with replacing existing fencing that's there that was never touched. Just because we want to make it look, and I appreciate his effort, I really do, to make it uniform.
Can we separate?
This invoice doesn't separate it.
So, okay, I'm really not trying to run off. I'm just trying to understand. So we're gonna keep the fencing, the fencing by the compactor didn't get touched.
Right.
Right? And so that's staying, okay. He's suggesting it doesn't stay. It's just the one on the retaining wall that got taken down, right?
Correct.
Yeah, in front of the recycle.
You know where the metal sheets were to.
I guess I'm asking the wrong two people, because you're not suggesting it, so I should be asking the person suggesting it, but. So he's saying he wants to now take down the fencing that was never touched and do it all?
You can talk to him, so that were.
That's what he explained to me, yes.
I'm not afraid of it. I don't think it needs to be. I don't think the stuff that's there now, it doesn't look nice, so. I mean, if it's to, so it all matches?
I mean, it's a transfer station.
I mean, look, if it was in disrepair, I would say, of course we need to take care of it.
Right.
But it's not in disrepair, so.
I mean, I don't think it is, but I don't know. He didn't say that.
Well, if it was in disrepair, that should have been part of the whole thing.
Right, exactly.
Well, yeah.
We can ask him, I mean, if it really does need to be fixed because there's not an issue with it, then, you know, yeah, okay, I don't want anyone falling on the compactor.
So we need to find out more about this one.
But if it's just because it's not the same color, I don't want to get that.
Would it not be the same color?
That's right, yeah, what did I say, the backwards? Sorry. Tongue tied, apparently.
Okay. Move to accept purchase order 1278 to Green Shadow Properties for one mowing of new and old town, and trimming. It's their sixth mowing of the year for $1,345.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Can I just make a comment? So
absolutely.
Everything, you know, all of them are toward a particular project,
sure.
Projects that we've already said yes to. there's always, not always, but there's, the catch-all is just sort of general. But even in his general, when I was looking it over, several of them were USDA related. And so I don't know where that one is, but I noted that right here. So we'll have post those particular expenses to the USDA legal budget line. The other thing, as long as we're on legal, if I can, at our non-meeting today with legal, we did, Steve stayed for a few minutes afterwards and we reviewed that list, you know, that email I'd sent him with the updates. And so he was fine with everything that we said. He talked the most about Comcast, and he is, he's going to, you know, continue to pursue that, you know, sort of slow walking, but he said that he's talked to
Mike Gillis.
Thank you, Mike Gillis, who's a resident and who does the Dover, he's the Dover media supervisor. And so when he'll run by Mike any agreement that Comcast does. So, but he is going to continue to work on that one. So, was there anything else that he said about what we?
No, it was all the things we had agreed to at our meeting. So.
Yeah.
That was all the conversation. So.
Okay. Fairbroy wants to let us know that they are now Consolidated Communications. Consolidated Communications, NASDAQ, CNSL, has closed on its merger with Fairbroy.
All right, so there you go.
We'll start getting
bills from Consolidated. Do you want to see this?
I don't utilize their service, but
I don't either.
But it's good to make note because when I start getting bills from Consolidated Communications, I'm like, what is this? Throw it out.
Actually, I'm not sure that we do because we use the
We use Bayring, actually, you're right. Yeah,
which has a different name now because
oh,
it was sold,
oh,
but,
oh.
And I don't remember. But so we don't really, the town does not use Fairpoint.
It does
for
transfer station.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That's the only one, right? Because
okay.
It was cheaper than going with Aaron. Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you for that.
I thought there was one.
But they
and
come
the
into play because
too.
Of the
That's right.
because of the poles.
This was addressed to Kate, Town of Rollinsford, Landmark Dividend. To build your wealth.
To what?
To build help build your wealth. Mm. Financial security. If you need immediate cash flow, build your business, a valuable nest egg.
What are they selling us?
I think it goes in the circular plane.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is for public and DOT bridge. And that's it.
Okay.
That is it.
All right. So before we go into non-public, any community input?
I have a question. How much does it cost to do a newspaper ad?
Oh, I think it was like $250 or something
like
that.
$250, $300 now.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
A lot more than it used to be. A lot more.
Why? What was that?
Well, I was thinking you could send out a special Salmon Falls Quarterly.
It has to be in your news in the newspaper, the public
of
newspaper of record.
Yeah, it's like a law.
So that's the what the RSAs say. So it's got to be like a Foster's. But I also know that the legislature was working on equivalencies kinds of things, so that you know something like wherever the RSA says this, you could just you know as long as you did this or this. So I need to find out from the municipal association whether. We can use an equivalent, or whether we really have to stick to the letter of the law and do it in Foster's. But thank you, Frank, for asking that. Anything else?
I have a public question.
I don't see why not. Fair is fair.
I thought I got there. When we were discussing the old highway shed, what do people think about disposing of it? Oh, I
want to hear from one. You just brought up my point that I was going and I couldn't remember. Rather, if we can't sell it, why not have somebody take it down? I mean, it's an eyesore, and it will be that much less we'll have to do when we build the new police department.
Property, but the building
I see.
To come off
yeah,
of our
yeah,
liability
yeah,
insurance.
Yeah, yeah.
I didn't even think about that.
Yeah,
Celia, what do you think?
I think if somebody else is willing to do the work, you're saving yourselves money from paying your employees to do it or hiring it out on your own time, and with the budget already being so tight.
And if they cut some trees down, it's a bonus.
Salve?
Yeah, I think it's fine.
So you don't think the public would have any?
There's more of them though.
As long as this, I mean.
Yeah, but I'm just, we're, you know, you're the only ones here, so we're just trying to keep you projecting. Yeah, it was a good question.
I'll ask other people that I know, but.
I don't think anybody has any ideas of how to use the building. And as long as there's no use for it, then it should go.
And it's gone out to bid twice.
Yeah.
And like you said, it went out to bid twice, so it's not like you're saying, here, take something.
Yeah.
Right.
I will check with the municipal association.
Just in case.
Just about the process, yeah.
We can do it, right?
Process and, you know, what do we have to sign?
Right, right, right.
Have to sign something, just to.
But I think a barter situation, definitely.
That is lovely.
Just because.
If they're willing to.
Sure.
Even if it's just a minimum bit of a.
Some kind of value.
Because there has to be a transaction.
Yeah, exactly, so it could be something like that, which is why that denominal.
When your grandma sells you your car.
Yes.
And especially if we have more land than what we had thought from the, maybe that more trees could be.
Cleared in the back though.
I would also verify that whoever is doing the work has their own liability insurance, so it doesn't fall onto the town.
That's what I want to check all of that out with the municipal association, what should we keep in mind when.
You would have to be assigned.
I know, like when we do paving and stuff, I always check with my paver or whatever to make, or my work around my house to make sure they have their own insurance, so it's not falling on my homeowner's insurance.
Gee, Celia, what have you paved? I haven't seen anything come through.
Years ago.
All right. Anything else? All right, then I'll entertain a motion to go into.
Who did they go into?
For.
Elegant.
Elegant.